afternoon and welcome to another edition of A Conversation with John Conenna. This afternoon, we are thrilled to have on legendary referee Wally Harris from the National Hockey League. The resume speaks for itself, Wally, but great to see you on here today here on the show. And what are you doing these days, young man?
Well, I'm trying to enjoy myself.
Okay. And that's the main thing, right, Wall?
That's it nowadays.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Normally on a Sunday, when I was that guy growing up in Chicago, I would always, it was synonymous with you, with the Blackhawks or anything else. I would always see on the game of the week, or I would see you doing a Blackhawk game from the old Chicago Stadium when Billy Ray was the coach and everything else. I got to ask you, you're born in Montreal, Canada, correct, sir?
Right.
And that some great days growing up in Montreal?
I did. I enjoyed this city. I moved up for about 15 years, but I'm back here now.
Right. Beautiful, beautiful. You know, we had an audio conversation with you a couple months back.
Yeah.
We're probably going on about maybe even a year ago, and it was great now that we could see you in person here. You had told me in the last interview that you started, you played hockey, of course. And I think you were telling me that you were a pretty good defenseman. You want to talk a little bit about those years?
Oh, yeah. I came up and played. I was in the Canadiens organization. I played for three teams in junior that they all owned here in Quebec.
Mm-hmm.
And every time they have a new team, they shipped me over. And to be the captain.
Right.
So I enjoyed that part. Then I got to, after 15 years, well, I was in 15, was 5 years in junior. Once you get to, as you know, once you get to 20, then you're not a junior anymore.
Right, that's it, right.
Right, but I was playing under the Canadian organization. So they had a team in Buffalo. This one was a six-team league NHL. So they asked me, would I go to Buffalo? So at first I said yes. And then I'm looking at it and I said, I know how long it's going to take you to get to the National League.
Right.
So I was supposed to get married in 3 years, within 3 years. And I said, the hell, if I play for Buffalo, I'm going to be gone for about 6-7 weeks before you ever get to the National. 6-7 years before you get to the National.
Sure. What was the name of the Buffalo team? Do you remember?
Hell.
Was it the Bisons?
Yeah, Buffalo Bisons.
I kind of remember reading something about the Buffalo Bisons. So when did you kind of know, Wall, that, okay, you know,
I did a couple of exhibition games with them, and then I had a chance to go into business also. So I decided I wasn't going to have a hockey career. I looked at it, and I wound up opening up my own sales foundry equipment and sale. And so I went that way. All of a sudden I said, I asked the people I took the business with. I represented 9 different companies. And the nice part about it, when I went on my own, I warehoused here in Montreal. And so I picked up all 9 companies and represented them.
I see. In
Eastern Canada.
Very nice. Well, then, but knowing after the junior career, when does the passion to become this great referee start for you? I mean, was it something you thought about, or what was going through your mind in regards to becoming a referee?
I started to do a little work with the kids here. The city here decided to start a hockey club for the kids. You know, they had the divisions all the way up to Bantam Juniors and what have you. So I did some officiating for them. And then doing that, I got seen by the pros and they asked me would I come and try out. And so Carl Voss picked me up. We said, we'd like you to try out for us. I said, you're a little older than most officials and break into the National League. We used to break them in when they're about 20 years old and develop them and take them maybe 4 or 5 years before they get to the National League.
Right.
So I said, yeah, I'll try out. We tried out and I did 3 games for them. And he asked me, he said, I'd like you to join the staff. He said, you're what we're looking for. You're a little older than the rest. And he said, anyway, you played against most of these fellows that are playing in American League because you're juniors. And like I said, there's 6 teams only in the National League. So
at that time, yeah, right. But Wally, I want to ask
players in the American League.
Wally, what was the criteria to become a referee? Especially now, here's how I look at it. 6 teams, that still in my mind is the best players in the world to make 6 teams.
Exactly.
I feel that hockey is watered down now, but that's a story for another day. So you, to become a referee, you had to be pretty talented to be noticed. What was the criteria, and did you feel very confident knowing that you could get to that criteria?
Well, after about 3 years in the juniors in the American League, they asked me to go up to the pros, try out with the pros. Well, you had a team out west. There was 12 teams out west. The American League had 8. We even did the Central League. The National League started the Central League. So there's 3 minor leagues really that were
exactly
developing for the National League.
But there was a lot of competition, correct, sir?
Oh, there was lots of competition. Well, like you said, at that time, when I started, we had 11 referees, 5 linesmen. That was it in the National League.
Right.
We covered the National League and the American League. We covered both leagues.
Sure. Wow.
My first trip, I went for 23 days, came home for 2, went for another 28.
Well, and it was a lot of trip. Was a lot of the travel.
Yeah,
by train.
We were all across America.
Sure.
You know, and we had a small staff.
And it was by train most of the time too, right?
Yes, train, bus, anybody.
Any way to get you there, yeah.
The only place you had a plane was you had to go to the West Coast. It was a long train ride.
Exactly. So you actually, do you start reffing in the American League and then you're brought up to the NHL?
Yeah.
So basically, it's how the player who comes out of the AHL then goes to the National Hockey
League. Same thing.
Okay, great.
They're working the same as they are.
And Wally, I never knew that, you know, about that. But again, what a time for you to, you know, going through all these phases that you did. And I still believe, maybe because we're both old school, I still believe that that was probably your era, and not because you're my guest today on the show, is the greatest era in hockey. I just believe that if I had to make a comparison of referees, players, just teams in general, and I know there were only 6, mm-hmm. I felt that you were part of the greatest era ever. Your first game is 1963-64, you told me in an audio interview, Rangers, Montreal.
That was it.
Yeah. What do you remember about that game? I mean, what do you remember? Did you have the butterflies? Did you have the nerves?
Well, I remember I was lucky. I wasn't too nervous. And when I got the assignment, I said, well, there's a great way to start. I said, Montreal playing in New York. So I was a little excited.
Sure.
But it went well. And I'll say one thing, I called 20 penalties. I called 19 penalties. I remember first three games, I called 19 penalties.
Wow.
Each one. Carl Voss comes in to talk to me. He's the one that hired me. And he said, Wally, he says, this is the pros now, not junior. He said, let them play hockey.
Let them play hockey.
Let them play hockey. So I went from one of those fellows that called it pretty close to probably calling less penalties than anybody throughout my career.
Wow. And Wallo, I will get to that later on here, but over the years, I mean, you let them play, right? You did let them play.
Let them play.
Yeah. Wally, in those beginning years, of course, I can't remember all the coaches, but of course, like in Chicago, we had Rudy Polis, we had Billy Ray, we had Emil Francis, we had Sid Abel, we had, of course, the great Montreal coach, I forget his name now, you shouldn't toll Blake, and of course, Punch Emlock. Were these guys intimidating in the sense of when you made a call? Did you hear them chirping? What was your style with these veteran coaches, you being now the new guy?
Well, as I said, like I told you, when I started, I called too many penalties. Then I learned not to listen to them and put them in their place. And if you're going to go by and go over and say, I've had enough of this yapping. And I wasn't going to put up with much. Otherwise, I wanted a career. And I didn't want it to be shortened.
Right.
Well, I let them know that I was going to referee the hockey game. They can coach it.
Exactly. So were you always a referee, or did you take even situations where you were a linesman?
Always a referee.
Never a linesman.
Never a linesman.
And let me ask you, let's just say that there was a shortage.
Yeah.
Could you have filled in as a linesman?
Yes, at times I've done that.
Right.
For an injury or something. But
you being...
We only had the two men.
Right, right. The gentlemen that I just... All the gentlemen that I just mentioned, you know, Emlock, Blake, Billy Ray, Sid Abel.
All senior referees, which we don't have today.
Right.
You know, you look at them and they're 32 teams. It's like players. There's players that could have never made it in a 20-team league.
But right. 32,
which is good for them because it gives them a chance to develop.
Exactly, exactly.
I was fortunate because I'd taken an engineering course. And so I had that behind me. And so when I went with the National Hockey League, I let them know. I said, I still own a business. And I said, I don't want to drop it. I was afraid they might say, well, you know, you're doing one for us.
Right.
They let me do it, and I did it, and I carried it along for 38 years along with my officiating.
Sure.
I warehoused in Montreal, and I had three people working for me, so I was a little more used to rough hockey and
sure.
What have you, because I've used to argue with engineers before, so right. Now I argue with coaches.
And now you're with coaches. During your tenure in the beginning years, was it? It was Mr. Campbell was the president of the league.
He
right?
was the one. Yes.
How was he to deal with in that era?
Oh, I tell you, he was straightforward. There was no fooling around with him. But at least he held you in. Remember, he held me in once. He said one of the supervisors complained that I was letting too much go. And So he came in and he said, "You threw a, they hired a coach in New York. He only lasted about half a year, but he came out of college.
Okay.
You know, and he was yappy all over the place. Well, I had an argument with him. I told him where to go. And of course, I got brought up in front of Campbell and I said, I remember the words. I said, "Mr. Campbell, this man is a, was a college coach and all he wants to do is question every call you make." He said, "You might have done that in college, but he's not doing it at the pro level."
Right.
That's why I had the argument with him. And so he just looked at me and said, "Good, I'm glad you told me what it was all about." He said, "That's fine."
So, yeah, I mean, it sounded like Campbell was this man who respected
you. He's good through, huh?
He respected your craft,
fool.
Yes.
No fool with it. Just tell him the truth.
Yeah, and you know, when we read the stories of Campbell, and of course the famous story was before even your time, was the game in Montreal when there was the riot over Maurice Richard. And, you know, I mean, he went there to that game. And, of course, you know, his life was endangered. But, again, I thought he handled that situation well in the mid-50s.
I think he helped me there. I went to that game.
Oh, you did?
For some reason. And I guess I was playing. I think I was playing for the Junior Canadians at the time. So I went to see that game. And yeah, that was scary when I went on, but he stood there. He was a tough individual.
Yeah, tough man. And, you know, my dad had a great word about people like that. He had a great presence to him. You know, when he would walk into a building, I mean, not that he demanded it, but you respected someone like that.
And yeah, you almost think it was like the king was walking in because everybody just stopped and looked.
Right. Right. And
if he was going to say something, it had to be important. He didn't waste words.
There was no beating around the bush.
No beating around the bush. Yeah, let's get to the point. Why are you here?
And I see that about you in this interview, that you respected him. He respected your crap. So that was a great way to look at it. And, right. You know, over the years, you've refereed over, geez, I mean, I'm just looking at the resume. The resume is, you know, fantastic. Over 953 games you reffed. You were part of, what, 6 Stanley Cup finals?
Yeah.
And, of course, a game that I will never forget, Wally, was that December 31st game. I think it was the Soviets.
Yeah, that was a beautiful game. You know, didn't know what to expect. I said, well, both teams can play hockey if they want to. And they played a beautiful game.
Yeah. But I got to ask you, Wally, was there a language barrier in that game with the Russians?
None at all. None at all. I went to the captain of the Russians and said, "If you want an interpretation on anything," I said, "ask me nicely," and I said, "you'll get one." You know, I had done them a couple of times before when they were visiting and touring Canada.
Yes.
And, so at least they knew who the hell I was.
Sure. Oh, no.
That made it easier.
And you know what? The tempo of that game, and I think that was the game where Dryden faced off, Dryden and Tretiak were the goaltenders.
That's it.
The tempo of that game, you again, Wally Harris, made them play the game. I mean, it's okay. Now, you guys are going to play this game. The tempo of that game is still talked about even in this modern era. You know, I mean,
it is. It's amazing.
Yeah, we're talking December 31st, 1975.
Yeah, I looked it up and I said, hell, I didn't realize it was that far.
Yes.
That old.
Yeah, no. Were there, even to this day, or even just to bring this up, I coached at the amateur level here in Illinois. I was fortunate to coach for about 19 years at the amateur level.
Right.
You know, as a coach, and I never tried to coach my son who played, I would always coach teams without my son to make my life easier. But you develop a favorite, you know, meaning on a team or a coach or even – was it hard for you sometimes? I mean, this is a question. Was it hard for you sometimes when were there teams in your era that could have been disrespectful to a Wally Harris and your staff? Were you sometimes, did they let you get under your skin, or you were pretty much always that straight and narrow?
No, I have to say nobody got under my skin, because I can argue with the best of them.
That's for sure.
And I don't mind saying what I'm thinking at the time. So, you got to show respect, but you also got to show that you're running the show, not them.
Right.
And it worked out well for me anyway.
No, that's great. You know, like I says, me coaching at the amateur level, my parents would always come up to me and say, wow, these referees are out to get us. And I says, the referee is the judge and the jury. He's not out to get you. We just got to play better hockey, I used to tell them. We're making a lot of mistakes. We're taking a lot of penalties. It's not the ref's fault that we took a penalty. But, you know, again, I'm sure even on the professional level, you heard that a lot. Like, you know, you're calling a bush game, or you're doing this, or you're doing that.
People don't realize, especially when you've been there, the longer you're in there, the easier it gets, because, you know, you still remember the arguments you had 5 years ago. I mean, I had more fun in Boston with that gang, and Chicago, same thing. You just go at each other. You know, and after it was over, I mean, if we passed each other in a hallway, you know, after calling your names or something, you probably say, well, that's a good game. And it was part of the game. I mean, right. you were releasing tension by saying something.
It's all in the heat
of it. It wasn't meant to each other.
Right, right. You know, over the years, and in our last time that I talked to you, it was fascinating to hear this from you. Let's say you do a back-to-back game, Philadelphia, Boston on a Saturday in Boston, and then you go to Philly on a Sunday afternoon, and there's tensions from that game the night before. Did you see a lot of it spill over where you knew, okay, you know, Schultz just fought O'Reilly, and this happened and that happened. We got to watch this now because the first period's going to be, you know, a barn burner. Did you talk to the two teams before to get it? Hey, listen, I'm not going to take any crap.
No, I didn't talk to the teams, but I talked to the players as we were skating around. Such as I said, look, I know what you did last night. You wanted to try it tonight. You won't be in this game very long. You know, I'm benefiting myself by saying something. That I know what happened last night. I didn't do the game.
Right.
So I said, but we're going to control this game. I said, either if I give you a penalty, go to the box. Otherwise, I said, I'll add the 10 on in a hurry.
Right.
I mean, you talk to them. They come out. Sometimes they would come by me and say, not you again. Don't you get tired of it? I've been tired years ago, your team. But
Right.
Well, I still get them.
Oh, sure. No, because that's... Did you feel that players held grudges over the years?
I think there are some, but very few.
Right.
There are some. You know, my answer was they were smart asses. And that was it. I mean, you know, they're probably the same way.
Sure.
With their friends at home. You know?
Right, yeah. And who knows, like you said, the next night they could be in a restaurant or in a bar having a beer the next night. And
that's things, right.
It's over. I got to ask you, being I'm also an ex-goaltender at the
amateur. Oh, dude.
Ex-goaltender on the amateur level. I know you had to be this biased man being the referee, but did you see, did you see some really great goaltending from where you stood?
I'm lucky where I stood. I saw the best, you know, and appreciated it. You know, the moves they had to make and anticipation of what to do, because, you know, it's not just the first shot. There might be two or three rebounds.
Right.
And the crest are up and down like yo-yos. And it amazes me some nights. Because sometimes I'm standing 2 feet away from them when these shots are coming. Sure. I made one mistake in my life and I corrected it in a hurry. It was in Chicago.
Oh, God.
And that's when we just started, the players start using that curved stick.
Yeah, Hall and Makita.
Oh, yeah. And Hall, all of a sudden, they had a double penalty. And all of a sudden, out comes Makita. And of course, Hall and I'm standing there like, the smart ass. I was 2 feet away from the goalpost.
Right.
And that puck came in. It was coming down the other side. And it curled right past my ear.
Whoa.
That was the last time I told us, last time I'm standing near the net when you're going to shoot.
Wow.
It was crazy. Because of that blade, it had a double whammy. It hit the front of the back of the blade, hit the front corner, and away it would go up or down. You never know where the hell it was.
Yeah, I mean, it was like a fast knuckleball.
Baseball. You're exactly right.
You know, Wally, I always read stuff about the great Glenn Hall, the goaltender, and he would say about Bobby and Stan, he goes, I did wear before he wore the mask, and when he went to St. Louis, he wore this protective shield. He goes, in practice, these guys had no mercy. They were firing cannons.
They don't care. I mean, you start the game and you would see them come down sometimes. First shot would be high at his head just to let him know they're around.
Yeah.
Just anything to try to shake him up a little bit.
Yeah, to set the tone of the day, for
it's
sure.
It's amazing how the goaltenders put up with.
Right. I can imagine.
With the game because, Christ, today is ridiculous. They're in the crease. There's four or five guys in the crease every goal.
Yeah, matter of fact, last night I was watching the Chicago-Buffalo game, and the Blackhawks, who lost the game, there were so many pileups in the crease, exactly what you just said. It's just like too much now is going on in this crease.
We used to have to say, if you want to go behind the goal or through the crease, you're still getting a penalty. That's when we started. They thought that was too tough. That's just ridiculous now. How do you get it? Because once the first shot goes in, it comes, the puck comes out, but there's two guys already standing in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's not the referee's fault. That's the rule.
I mean, exactly.
Why they loosened up that rule, I'll never understand.
Wally, I want to ask you, I don't follow the game as much, and me and you have had a lot of phone conversations. You've become basically a good friend of mine over the last year. But I don't watch the game like I used to. And you were telling me that you really aren't into the game. Do you think hockey really now is just this different game now, like what we just talked about?
Well, I watched the other night. I didn't watch much last year.
Right.
I didn't like the way it's, like you said, it was played. But I watched last week. And I said, where's the substance? Everybody seems to be going everywhere.
Yes.
I mean, the passes are back and they try to get into the zone and then they go up, go in the big square and then circling around. Well, it's a good play, but the game is completely different.
Yeah, definitely. somebody, I know we always say, Wally, that we can't compare eras, but I don't know. I know the game is faster. I know they have these composite sticks. They have this lighter equipment. These goaltenders are dressed up I wish I would have had that equipment that they have now. When you looked at guys like Bernie Parent, Tony Esposito, Terry Sawchuk, all these guys, they didn't have this kind of equipment. I know the game is faster, but I wish there was a way to compare. When you talk about guys like Gordie Howe, Makita, Hall, Davey Keon, Frank Mahovlich, those were great athletes.
Oh, yeah, big difference. They were playmakers.
Yes.
Nowadays, get over the blue line. The game today is you're going to pass, pass, pass to somebody has a slap shot.
Right.
You know, and it's like the puck's going every which way, waiting for somebody to get it clear. I mean, it's a new system. But like you, I'm not really pleased with the system. They might like it, but then I'm not out there anymore anyway, so.
Right. Well, you know, Walt, one thing that you taught me over the last year, 32 teams, I think it is now, right? There's 32
teams. Yeah, 32 teams.
So in my way of thinking, I mean, okay, I know there's 32 teams and with a better chance to become a professional maybe, but I just feel, Wally, that it's watered down. It's not the same. I know things change in life, but I just, again, feel that era of your era was the era of really hard work, determination of those athletes.
Yeah, well, it's like you look at the youth today. I mean, some of these young kids are great, going to be great hockey players. And they're getting a break early. I mean, before, with only 12 teams, I mean, where could you get a break? You know, that was the best. We had the best 24 hockey players in the league.
In the league, right.
In the league. I mean, now you've got, oh, Chris, I don't know, what have we got, over 300 or 400 people in the league now?
It's insurmountable, right, exactly.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's hard to remember who the hell's who.
Sure, sure.
So you got a lot of talent, but it hasn't got the backup.
No. Wally, how many games would you ref in your heyday a week?
Well, I would do. I've done seven and seven nights because of injury.
Sure.
That other thing, we didn't have any spares. But you do a minimum of three, usually four.
3 to 4 games a week. And that's, and I mean, here's the thing that people don't understand. We turn on a TV, we see Wally Harris, but Wally Harris is going to work. You know, yeah. Wally Harris has got to do his job, you know. Wally, I want to end it with just a couple of things. Again, the resume is fantastic. Loved alone the fact that you wanted to come back on because I really wanted to see you face-to-face, and I really appreciate you doing this. No, again, like good. I said, you have been part of some really memorable games in hockey. You are still looked up to, in my eyes, when I read things about you, as a great mentor to your craft of being one of the greatest referees in the world of the game. I have to ask you a question because for me, it kind of nips away at me about Wally Harris. What would it mean to Wally Harris to be inducted into the Hall of Fame?
Well, I think I strive for it would be, I don't know, sensational. I'd be so pleased, but if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen.
Well, what I would like to say and end it on this note today here, and this has been a thrill for me, and if we can always do it again and again, I can always find 1,000 things to talk to Wally Harris, but I have to say this in closing of this. As a young man growing up in Chicago and watching this game, and I have videotapes of games. Every time I turn around, you were reffing the game. And this was a thrill for me some 40 years later to interview you. I feel that it would be an injustice to hockey, to referees, to linesmen, if Wally Harris is not inducted into the Hall of Fame. Sir, you deserve your just due. And that's all I want to say today. But the biggest thing I want to say today, Wally, is I thank you for coming on. And this has been an honor for me today.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the kind words. It's better than the words I used to get on the ice anyway.
Well, if you were coaching on the amateur level, I would have had some words for you, but I would have hugged you.
I bet you did. I bet you would.
You were a great one. And, continued success, and promise me that we will always keep in touch. You are my mentor and a gentleman looking up to you.
Well, thank you very much. It's always a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you, Wally. And good night, everyone. Yeah.